Okay, so we had some power outage last week, so I cannot upload the latest version of my presentation to Magic Site before the lecture. I did it now. So briefly, what we considered last time was Kelly transform. We study it first in the classical complex analysis setup of complex numbers. And main idea is that it's a linearized action of corresponding subgroup, which used to build homogeneous space for complex analysis with a subgroup K. And we have action of this subgroup given by the rotation of the unit circle. So image of the Kelly transform maps upper half plane to the unit circle. So here is main advantage of Kelly transform, what we have some simplified picture for corresponding rotations. But disadvantage is what we lost universality. Upper half plane is universal domain for all free geometries. But after we are doing the corresponding Kelly transform, we came to different images depending on which numbers are used for this Kelly transform. Similar picture can obtained for double numbers. So subgroup we generate corresponding homogeneous space is A prime. So it's cousin of subgroup K, but this time it's built with cosine and sine function, which are hyperbolic. In the upper half plane, action of this subgroup is looking a bit tricky. So it's on the with left picture. But on the right hand side, after Kelly transform, we get the hyperbolic rotations. So images are with corresponding hyperbolas. And that is transformation, so-called Lorentz bust from relativity, which transform corresponding space-time geometry with one-dimensional space. So actually, in this, if we will compare the previous picture and this picture, we have a good explanation of different orthogonality relation in corresponding geometries. Actually, in all cases, the orthogonality can be defined. Orthogonality can be defined as follow. So vertical and horizontal axes are orthogonal by definition. So just this is orthogonal object in all geometries. But when any other pair of orthogonal directions is obtained by corresponding rotations. So in complex analysis, this is just orthogonal rotation. So after we did it, the well-known orthogonality, which preserve angle, will be looks like that. So we just rotate by the same angle the orthogonal axes. What happened in hyperbolic case, we still have initially these axes, horizontal and vertical, which are orthogonal. And then we are using the hyperbolic rotation. What hyperbolic rotation are doing? They transform points or move points along corresponding hyperbolas. So by the same angle. So horizontal axis will be moved in this direction by some angle, and vertical axis will move in this direction by the same angle. So we have that hyperbolic orthogonality condition, which we said before, that light cone bisect the angle between corresponding two directions. So if orthogonal light cone bisect with angle, then we have the orthogonality in hyperbolic sense. So just is the same definition, but with different rotation as it was done in elliptic case. Here there is some structures corresponding, which we discussed on previous lecture, and transformation of light cone and its future and past condition. Here I add some references to Wikipedia resources, so we ask money as anyone. So here is the image of this object which we obtain cross-cup. So it's self-intersecting if we are modeling it in three dimensions. So in four dimensions, it can be done without self-intersection. But it's one-sided. So once I am traveling to this point on the outside surface of this cross cup, after passing intersection point, and I will be on inside, so-called inside part of this cone. So that give us the image of cross cup object, which we build as a double cover for corresponding double number plane. And here again, Wikipedia reference to redshift in extragalactic astronomy, but in Wikipedia, only version with Doppler effect or a Doppler vision and expanding universe after Big Bang is presented. It's not speaking about conformal invariants of the space-time and the inversion, which are discussed in the book of Siegel. So here again, briefly, we have images of different conformal disks, either in elliptic, parabolic, or hyperbolic situation, and there is just a feeling what it's a common family. And just coming back here to the parabolic rotations, just the orthogonality as we discussed before. Again, in parabolic case, we start from orthogonal axes, and when we are doing parabolic rotations, here, this is this picture, what happened, what vertical axis, vertical direction remain constant. In parabolic transformation, all vertical directions are special lines. They are not transformed to anything. But the horizontal axis can be transformed to any direction. And so vertical line is will be orthogonal to any direction in parabolic case. This is images of parabolic orthogonality, which we had before. There is interesting possibility to have a bigger set or a different set of parabolic rotation somehow to resolve parabolic degeneracy, but I will not cover with it in this year, so it was covered in previous years, and I will circulate information where you can see lectures, recorded lectures from previous year covering that parabolic rotation stuff, and also application of Erlangen program for the functions and operators that will not be covered in this year lectures, and it will not be examinable. So this is the stuff from the previous lecture. What we will speak today is like concluding remarks, where the story can be continued, in which direction that can be pushed forward. And actually, there are quite a lot of interesting possibilities open here for further research. So just a brief reminder of the setup which we had. So main transformation symmetry which was used in this lecture are fractional linear transformation, which has that expression one. and we consider it for real numbers, complex numbers, dual numbers, and double numbers. But there are much more wider possibility to treat with this type of expression. Actually, parameters A, X, B, C, and D can be elements of Clifford algebra or quaternions. So it's not only 2 times 2 story which can be told in this framework. We can make it for general different dimensional situation. And the geometry behind corresponding Clifford algebra can be also taken with a different signature. So signature here PQ, P is number of elliptic coordinates, and Q is number of hyperbolic coordinates. Or you can say what it's in term of physical terms, it's p-dimensional space, q-dimensional time, which can be considered as a geometry. And good news is what quite a lot of technique which we have used here can be carried out even in many dimensions with the same 2 times 2 matrices. So when we are considering with linear fractional transformation, which defined in Clifford algebras, we still may be interested in the quadratic forms, which represent cycles in that multi-dimensional situation. So it will be some conic surface, quadratic surface like spheres, hyperboloids, paraboloids in 3 dimension, and even something more complicated in higher dimension. And for such a quadratic expression, we associate Filmer-Springer-Knops matrix, which has the structure very similar to what was treated in our course for 2 dimensions. And the reason for consideration of these matrices is what our quadratic form can be simply represented by means of matrix multiplication, what with Filmer-Springer-Knops matrix. And when it's turned out that corresponding invariants of matrix theory, so we can just prove in the same way as the result what Moebius transformation, fractional linear transformation for variable X in this form projective space represented by matrix multiplication for the corresponding Filmer-Springer matrices. So that correspond to theorem which we had in our course. So if I can find it quickly. Yeah, so it's this theorem which still true for the a much wider situation in many dimensions. And similarly to our course, we can introduce the inner product between quadratic forms, between corresponding geometrical object cycles, as a trace of the product of Filmer-Springer-Knops matrices. Possibly we need to take real part or some projection to the corresponding one-dimensional direction to get just ordinary number. And again, expression in Clifford algebra's language will be rather similar to the expression which we had for inner product in the our course in 2 dimensions. So just as was said before, we have a rather similar expression. And then for Clifford algebras, it's again useful to have a normalization of cycles. That condition will play essential role today. We want to normalize cycles by the condition what inner product with itself is plus or minus 1. And that is possible to do always whenever the psych is not isotropic, either if it's not self-orthogonal, if inner product with itself not equal to zero, then just by scaling matrix, and everything here in our theory is projective, so scaling by constant does not change object in that description, so we just get the right normalization. What kind of relation we can obtain in this way? Well, quite a lot, actually. From the expression which we had before, it's easy to see what orthogonality to well, actually, from the expression of the cycle, if we have k equal to zero, then actually it scales, so coming back to our quadratic form, it scales quadratic term, k equal to zero, kill quadratic term, we have just linear expression, so k equal to zero means our cycle is flat, it's a linear object. But k equal to zero from this inner product, we can see, can means what just our cycle is orthogonal to the cycle with m equal one and all other parameters equal to zero. This is a cycle at infinity. So recall the infinity represented by a cycle with value zero, 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 one. So this is K, L, N, M. So in term of that inner product, when we see what condition, what K equal to zero is, means orthogonality to the cycle at infinity. So straight lines are, are circles which pass the infinity in other way. Elsa, we already met another object. This is Lobachevsky line in the upper half plane. This is cycles which are orthogonal to the real line. So that is another invariant condition. And in higher dimensions, instead of real line, we have a certain hypersurface which separate the space-time into two halves. And then orthogonality produces the corresponding object. So here come isotropic condition when a cycle is orthogonal to itself. So inner product of a cycle with itself is equal to zero. And that is a condition which we already identified with the condition what cycle is a point. So that is easy again to verify. In higher dimension, it's again work out, but points in high dimension in spaces or just in spaces with indefinite metric need to be replaced by light cone, says. We have discussed with zero radius cycles before. So again, where is the picture from our course? It's here. So zero radius cycles, this is self-orthogonal isotropic cycles. So in simplest case, it's either point or the light cone passing a point or some kind of other quadrix in special relation to itself. When come ordinary orthogonality, this is what we again discuss. If two cycles have inner product equal to zero as matrices, when the images as points in RPQ will be orthogonal in rather standard way. Another relation which we discussed again, it's tangency of the cycles. So it's given by this condition. It was discussed in the relation to the Cauchy Schwarz inequality. So in our course, we already put this condition together. So it's again is still meaningful in higher dimension and give us the possibility to represent orthogonality in this simple way. So what relation we have obtained on this line, they are already quadratic with respect to parameters of cycles which entering it. So previous relation orthogonality between two cycles was linear in the coefficient. Here we have a quadratic one. So solutions are typically come in double numbers as for any quadratic equation. And just because if you are looking for a tangent circle, for example, there are typically two solutions, one with inner tangent and another with outer tangent relation. There is also quadratic relation which generalize a previous one when we have here identity with here it's come with parameter one, but here we come with a parameter with special value theta. And that just generalize the previous in term of its define in most common situation, the intersection angle between circles. So that parameter theta, which we have here, so this is just intersection angle, or rather the cosine of other way around, sorry. So theta is equal to the cosine of the angle phi between the intersection of the cycles. So of course, the special situation is a cosine equal to zero when we have orthogonality, or cosine is equal to one. In this case, we have the tangency relation. So two circles will be tangent. And actually, that is still meaningful for circles which are not intersecting. In this case, theta take values bigger than one. So, and if we will look for the solution, so that corresponds to the case theta bigger than one. So angle of intersection here became imaginary. So if we still interpret it as a cosine of some angle, it has solution with complex number, imaginary angle between cycles. So it's called inversive distance, and it's quite a popular topic in Euclidean geometry and classical geometry. Inversive distance still expressed in terms of our inner product. Finally, there is so-called generalized Steiner power. Just classically, what is the power of a point with respect to circle? So it's defined simply as if you take the equation which define the circle, say cycle, better to write it just faster. And a substitute value of a point, so point with coordinate x, y, for given cycle has a power p given by this expression. Of course, if p is equal to c to zero, that means what point x, y belong to the given cycle c. But if it's not equal to zero, it's geometrically that value measure how far our point is from the cycle C. And geometrically, that is tangential distance. So we put a tangent to the circle from given point, and that distance here give us P. So tangential distance. And actually, that notion can be generalized if we replace P point here, sorry, XY, which we may treat as zero radius cycle, but by arbitrary cycle. So we actually can introduce what is called Steiner power. So whenever we have two cycles, we are able to put a joint tangent for them. Of course, the solution is not unique. There are outer and inner tangent, common tangent. And that Steiner power is given just with distances. So it's cross tangential distance in other way. So it's again a very well respected geometrical object in many texts, and many interesting results is obtained geometrical result for that cross tangential distance. And as you see, here is presented just natural expression in terms of our inner product for cycles. Again, this is a quadratic relation. And what is interesting here, what we always for this quadratic relation can eliminate these quadratic terms by the normalization which we said. So assume we are solving a geometrical problem trying to find given for given set of cycles, find an unknown cycle which has a certain cross tangential distance or has certain tangential properties. And then to solve this relation, which are quadratic, we will simplify thing if assume that we have just the proper normalization, what inner product of a cycle of itself is equal to one. That means what we may have a problem which contains several quadratic relation, and in this case all of them are replaced by a single one, and that actually simplifies the solution, analytical solution of this problem. And in the software which I have developed, that is used to find analytical solutions and rather efficient way for geometrical problems. So you can just pull set of relation which your unknown cycle need to satisfy, and then that software will solve it for you and produce coefficient of cycle which is having desired properties. And interestingly, we have a similar idea in some study of coherent states, when we also use a certain fixed relation, quadratic relation in derivatives, and we just use that fixed quadratic relation in derivatives to reduce the order of differential operator to linear one, and that partial differential operator, partial differential equation of first order is solvable by standard method of characteristics. So the same idea work for geometry, and the same or similar idea work for a certain problem in quantum mechanics. So now I wish to present the extension of corresponding geometry, which we considered in this course, to a different object. So what we did in this course, we studied property of cycles which are quadratic expressions or quadratic forms represented by circles or hyperbolas or parabolas. And then now I will say what collection of such circles, several circles with a certain relation between them, still expressed in terms of invariant product between cycles, can represent a much wider set of geometrical objects. The first problem which we will consider is the extension of Moebius transformation, say from real line to the upper half plane. So let me recall again at the beginning of our course, we considering corresponding homogeneous spaces. And when we factorized SL2R with respect to affine group, we find a homogeneous space, which is the upper half, which is just real line, and we have a fractional linear transformation of real numbers as corresponding action of SL2R. So when we consider it homogeneous spaces with respect to one-dimensional subgroup, and this was corresponding upper half planes with dual, double or complex numbers, and we still have a linear fractional action of corresponding numbers. But these two models for real numbers and for hypercomplex numbers, which are presented here, they are not completely separated. So this action and this action, although they come from a different group, besides sharing the same fractional linear form, they also have the geometrical connection, because we may think again about real line to be just boundary of the upper half plane. So we have either Moebius transformation in the upper half plane, so it's fractional linear transformation in the upper half plane, so say on C, and we have fractional linear transformation on the boundary on R. And connection here is geometric in the sense what the same matrix produce the fractional linear transformation of the closed upper half plane, so upper half plane, open upper half plane unified with its boundary, with the real line. So that became a continuous transformation of these two sets. And what is known again from the classical work of Poincare, what we may extend this fractional linear transformation from the real line to the upper half plane in rather natural geometric way. So that extension is done geometrically as follows. So we can take the pair of Lobachevsky lines. So this is half circles with the diameters on the real line. So say for this point, I have this half circles. Of course, this Lobachevsky line, half circles, are completely defined by their diameters. So they're completely defined by these diameters. And so if I know how points are, so this is my point P here, if I know how my points will be transformed on the real line, so I can find images of my diameters then. So I know what my green diameters will come here, my red diameter on the real line come here after Moebius transformation. So I will rebuild the corresponding half circles. So that will be the image of point P. So this is how Poincare extension from the real line can be extended to the complex plane. So here, like mathematical statement is, it doesn't matter which two particular half circles you are choosing to represent this point P. Clearly, there are infinitely many such half circles with property passing point P, but all these half circles, which is maybe not very obvious, eventually pass through the same point P prime after corresponding linear transformation of the real line. So this is Poincare extension. And what we can add to the classical setup, what actually there is nothing special with Lobachevsky line, half lines here. We can consider circles which make any fixed angle with the real line. So instead that right angle, half circles, we can take arbitrary angle and then represent points by such collection of cycles, and it's still an image of point P can be deduced in this way. And moreover, there is nothing special in circles. We can take parabolas or hyperbolas with the same relation, passing one point and making the fixed angle with the real line. Then images under fractional linear transformation of these circles will still pass single point, and in this way we obtain the different extension, different type of Poincare type extension from real line to the upper half plane. And like only possibilities which we have here are known to us already through consideration of the subgroup of SL to R. So all possible action which we got in such extension will be simply action on dual, double, and dual, double, and complex numbers. So this is how Poincare extension acts. Next object which we may consider are logarithmic spirals. So logarithmic spirals can be found at any scale. So if we look on huge galaxies, then the shape of these galaxies is having logarithmic spiral form. If we look to microworld and say elementary particles in the Wilson chamber in magnetic field, the orbit will be the same type of curve, the logarithmic spirals. If we look on the shape of shell or flowers, sunflower here, again, we can easily see the same shape of logarithmic spiral. So a moment of reflection reveal what there is nothing really magical here. The natural explanation came from the fact what we have in all cases. Either the simple automorphic equation, which just saying what rate of change for a function is proportional to function itself, and that automorphic equation to some extent is rather fundamental, and as a linear approximation can be used for a lot of natural processes. So on any scale, galactical scale or atomic scale, so just first approximation to almost any process may be having such a form. Then corresponding solution for complex C. So C is a complex number here, give us, as it's well known, Y to be the ECT, which give us the logarithmic spiral on the complex plane. So nothing magical here. Then that logarithmic spiral has a very natural marriage to the linear fractional transformation. What we will obtain in this case is known as the loxodromes or rhomb lines. Again, looking in the Wikipedia, so here is the picture. So if we will make a permanent angle to traveling on a ship in the ideal globe, then we always end up either on the north or south pole, except we are traveling with 90 degrees angle beta along the equator. So with any other angle, we will end up on the one or another pole. And property of these lines, what while we are making infinitely many rotation around our point of destination, the distance to the point of destination is finite. So the total length of the logarithmic spiral all the loxodrome is a finite number, which is again maybe not very obvious, but we have simply here very fastly convergent series. After each rotation, the distance decreases geometrically, so it's easy to sum up that numbers to find that object. And that type of curves appears on many occasions. For example, in complex analysis, singular integral operators are studied on Carlson arc, and loxodromes are just models for such Carlson arcs. So here again, that representation and connection with the constant angle on the globe. So if we have here a logarithmic spiral and we put it on the such pencil of concentric cycles, when angle of intersection with every cycle will be constant. And we may simply record to parameterize such logarithmic spiral, we may parameterize where two consecutive points after full turn. So if we will make a Moebius transformation of this picture, then the pencil of concentric cycle will be transformed to another pencil. So we already seen pencils of cycles in on many occasions in our course. So we have just this type of pencil with two cycles in this case. And loxodrome is characterized by the same properties for this elliptic pencil of cycles. We have a constant angle of intersection. So that is provide us with the parametrization of loxodrome by means of cycles. Here we have a triple. So this is two red cycles from one pencil and the green cycle from orthogonal pencil of cycle, such that intersection of loxodrome with red and two red circles coincide with the intersection with the green circles. Obviously, we have infinitely many such cycles here, with triple of cycles which parameterize the same loxodrome. So there is certain equivalence relation between these triples of cycles, which can be expressed analytically in terms of, again, inner product between cycles. So just run the animation showing that infinitely many different triples for the same loxodrome. So we have here just still at any moment of time, we have a pair of red and one green cycle from orthogonal pencil, which still parameterize the same loxodrome, so that triples shall be deemed to be equivalent. And these equivalent triples, again, produce certain higher dimensional object, which allow us to treat loxodrome in the spirit of Erlangen program. So we still use linear fractional transformation, calculate a lot of quantities, say even if two loxodromes are given, to find an intersection angle between them in terms of these triples or evaluate other conditions, it's still possible using that parametrization. Another object, and this time from the mathematical analysis and number theory probably. So this is a representation of real numbers by means of continued fraction. Actually, this is just another form to use the Euclid algorithm. So if you will think about Euclid algorithm of P and Q being coprime numbers, and how we are using Euclid algorithm to expand, say, P as N times Q plus certain remainder M, and then make further steps in with Euclid algorithm. So coefficients N, which appears here, will be used just as this number in the expansion of a fraction p over q with rational number. And then using the and that process will stop, of course, for integer p and q. At some point, it will stop at some one at the end. So that continuous fraction will have finite length. For real numbers, we may use a similar procedure, but we will have infinite continued fraction. And so here, there are continued fraction, first term for two fundamental constant, e and pi. And we can see that convergence of for pi is much faster. So there is certain geometrical representation of this continuous fraction. Again, by cycles, by infinite family of cycles, there is cycle A naught, which represented by the horizontal line at passing point one. And then there is a cycle A1, which is just tangent to the real line, and that horizontal cycle A0. Cycles which tangent to real line is called horocycle in classical geometry. So then the main connection with our topic is that a continued fraction may be treated just as a sequence of linear fractional transformations of special form with form applied to the points on the upper half plane. And then the speed of convergence for this continued fraction can be deduced just from behavior of two image points, zero at infinity. And to represent it, we may pick up a pair of cycles, initial cycles, which one which are tangent to the real line. One is tangent at the point zero. This is green horocycle, and another is tangent to the real line at infinity, and that it will be just a red parallel line to the real axis, horizontal red line. So we have two such green and red cycles where mutual disposition is not very important, actually. It just need to be in some Moebius-invariant relation. So they can be either tangent or orthogonal, or maybe having some other relation. And then we may look for the corresponding images. So there is a third cycle here, again, which pass zero, it's blue one, which pass zero and pass infinity. So again, that position of this three cycle, red, green, and blue, can be arbitrary, but that shall be the property which we are satisfied and the equivalence representation. And then a sequence of Moebius transformation which define a continuous fraction is just visualized by the images of this free cycle by means of Moebius transformation. That relation between them is a tangency or orthogonality will be, of course, preserved by corresponding Moebius transformation. Well, probably I will not be too rush, and we are close to the end of the lecture, so probably some extra material I will record a separate video from my office better. So let's consider just very last example. That is interesting application of classical geometry to certain modern research topic in integrability systems, so which was discovered. So somehow, again, classical geometry may look like already a topic which is out of scope for active researchers, but it turned out what classical topics are never die. They just resurrect again and again in different situation. And here is a very nice example of it. So let's consider the mechanical problem when I say I have 4 points A, B, C, D, joined by either roads. So this is that 4 points A, B, C, D, joined either by roads or ropes. And there are some forces applied here along with roads and ropes in such a way what our system is static. So the condition is what sum of all forces at every point, which come from three directions, that green directions at every point A, B, C, D, shall be equal to zero. How to solve that problem? And Maxwell in 19th century proposed very elegant mathematical description. So that can be done as follow. So we just build the circles which are circumscribe every 3 points in this diagram. So there is, say, circle here which circumscribe A, D, C, or a circle which circumscribe C, D, B. So for all 3 points from that 4 points, we find such a circle. Then for these circles, we put their corresponding centers, just using the label, say, A, for a circle, a center of the circle, which circumscribe all points except A, and so on, so on. So by the standard relation, if we will join center of these circles, it's turned out that corresponding intervals will be orthogonal. So for say BD is orthogonal to A1, C1, and say CB with A will be orthogonal D1, A1. So as you see, we take 2 points as defining interval, and then two other letters which are not participating in this interval labeling, we put just to the red one. So we have here orthogonality things. And the property is here what if we will rotate by 90 degree red triangle or red shape by 90 degree, then due to this orthogonality, we will have corresponding coincidence of direction. So C1, A1 will be parallel after rotation by 90 degree to BD interval. And then the length of A1, C1 will be just the force which need to be applied to BD. So just because three forces here making a triangle, so where sum is equal to zero in the red triangle, three sides produce zero, so we have solved the Maxwell problem. So we say that static problem. And so it turned out what this diagram and many other configuration in classical projective geometry just produce exactly the same